praise him with your face down. Praise him with the trumpet, praise him with a loud sound. Heaven is a party, join the celebration. Come on everybody, time to start dancing.
Kingdom first. Will you stand with us this morning as we sing this together?
God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior is. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face in certain days, because Christ lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. One day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he reigns. I can face tomorrow, because he lives. All fear is gone, because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Let's pray together. Father, we are amazed at what you've done for us. Father, that you gave up, you sacrificed your only son for us so that we could have life. He took our place on the cross. He paid the penalty of our sin. Father, you are so loving and kind. For you so love the world that you gave your one and only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but will have eternal life. Thank you that because he lives, we can face tomorrow and all our fear is gone. We worship you today, Father. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Psalm 32 tells us that we have joy because of what the Lord has done for us. It says, "Blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them. Be glad in the Lord. Rejoice and shout for joy." Our joy does not come from within ourselves, from our own strength. And we know that it doesn't come from the circumstances around us. We have joy because of the assurance we have in knowing who our God is and what he has done for us. And we together as the house of the Lord have joy this morning. Amen. Well, we want to teach you a new song today that reminds us that we get to have joy through the Holy Spirit. And so we're going to sing the chorus for you this morning as we begin. And then we invite you to join in with us, express your joy this morning, whether that's through clapping your hands, dancing, moving, singing, however you want to express that today. We invite you to do that as we sing this together.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory.
There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We sing to the God who heals.
We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We were the beggars,
'cause we were the beggars. Now we're royalty.
We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted,
redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Sing it again.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Sing it out.
There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
Amen. You may be seated. We don't have to go to a place for God's presence to be. He dwells in and among us. In Ephesians, Paul writes that God is making a dwelling place for himself among us by his Spirit. And so we can celebrate that as we worship this morning. Great singing. As the body of Christ and as the house of the Lord, we have a lot of work to do, fellowship-wise, service-wise, and we are called to do that. And there's a lot of opportunities for you to get involved in that work that God is doing. One of the big things that's coming up is kids camp. Last summer, we had a smaller kind of condensed version. We called it mini kids camp because of COVID. But this summer, we're pulling out all the stops, and it's going to be a big deal. So this is July 26th through August 1st. We need all hands on deck for this. Be on the lookout for our first information informational meeting, which will be coming out in the next few weeks. We want you to be a part of this, mark your calendars for it, and even be praying now for new kids to come and for kids that are already here to be encouraged and grow in their faith as well. This is going to be an awesome, awesome week, so mark your calendars for that. This week, our first official Parkside softball game is happening on Thursday night at 7:30. So if you're part of the team, you should probably be there. If you're not part of the team, you can be there and cheer everyone on as well. It's at the DeWitt Sports Complex in Zeeland at 7:30. Make sure you're cheering on our team or participating in that if you're part of the team as well. We also have a golf league that's starting next Tuesday. So not this Tuesday, but the following one. There's a men's league already kind of forming, but if you want to be part of that, talk to Gary Barton or Pastor Gary as well. If you're a lady and you want to play golf too, we're also starting a women's league at that same time. So talk to Judy if you're interested in that, and she's going to get a team together. You can also sign up on the Welcome Center back by the offices and mark those on your calendars as well. One big thing that's coming up, and it'll be a little bit of a shift for us, but I think it's going to be a good one. We are going to transition back to one service starting on May 30th. And so we want you to mark your calendars for that day. We'll start our summer schedule for the rest of the summer. The service will be at 10 a.m., and we'll have one service. We still want to be sensitive, though, to those who are cautious and need to wear masks. So we will have a mask-only section probably in the back. But make sure you have your calendar marked for 10 a.m. on May 30th for our one service that we're transitioning back to. We'll continue that through the summer as well. One thing that we want you to be praying for, and we prayed over this couple this morning in our first service, but Tom and Cheryl Boot are heading out to Kenya this next Saturday to serve as medical missionaries for an entire month. And so be praying for safety for them. They have some good contacts there already with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ, and so be praying for encouragement for them and for the people that they're going to, but then also opportunities to serve and also share the gospel with people that may have never heard it before. This is going to be a great time for them, so be praying for Tom and Cheryl Boot and safety and transitions and logistics and all of that, but most importantly, that God's will would be done, that they may share the gospel with people who have never heard it before. As we continue our service, I'd like to invite Pastor Gary and Pastor David up. We're going to have a responsive reading. It will be on the screens for you. In yellow font, we'd invite you to say the words that are in yellow font, and we'll kind of rotate through the white font. But would you stand with us as we participate in a responsive reading together this morning?
Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient.
All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath.
But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved.
Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone, and the new is here.
Therefore, one time we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another.
But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior. The new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here.
We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life, for we have been united with him in a death like his. We will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his.
For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin.
The new creation has come. The old has gone. the new is here. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. The new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here.
For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect.
Father, great is your name in all of the earth. Your word is eternal and your faithfulness never ending. Thank you for showing your kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Turn our hearts toward him in love and delight this morning. May he receive our worship and be glorified. In his name we pray. Amen. Please remain standing.
And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Amen. All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Thou burnest sun with golden beam. Thou silver.
all things their Creator bless, and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Washed by His blood, come and rejoice in His great love. Oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Christ has defeated every sin. Cast all your burdens now on Him. Oh, praise Him. Oh, shall return in power to reign. Heaven and earth will join to say, oh, praise Him. Alleluia. Then who shall fall on bended knee? All creatures of our God and King.
Of our God and King. If we do not praise Him, then who will? Luke chapter 19, when Jesus is arriving in Jerusalem and all the people in Jerusalem are crying, Hosanna, Hosanna, the Pharisees say something really interesting. They say, tell your followers to stop. And Jesus' reply in that time is, if they stop worshiping, then the rocks will cry out. You see, rocks weren't created to worship. But do you know who was and is? We are. So all creatures of our God and King, let us worship and praise the one who made us, our Creator. Not just who made us, but who saved us. So thank you for worshiping with us this morning and proclaiming to the Lord who He is and what He's worthy of. You may be seated. Children, come on down and we'll dismiss you for Sunday school, children's church. Right, that was so fast. Good morning. Do you guys know? Well, question for you. Can rocks talk?
No.
No, are you sure? Have you ever seen a rock talk?
No.
No? They're not living things, that's right. But do you know that Jesus says that if we don't sing praises to Him and worship Him, do you know that the rocks will cry out and worship? Do you know that Jesus can make that happen? Only He can do that, all right? So I'm gonna pray for us, and then you guys can go back with Miss Jen. All right, but not yet, not yet. Hold on, hold on. They're so excited. All right. All right. Let's pray. Okay, let's pray. Hold on. All right. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for who You are and the fact that You've created us to worship You. So, Lord, we ask that You bless these kids as they go to church and they learn about You. Lord, would You also be present with us as well as we prepare our hearts to know You. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to have you here this morning. Welcome in the name of the Lord. And if you're visiting for the first time, we give you a special welcome and trust that you'll be able to join with us as we have already worshiped through prayer, scripture reading, songs of praise and adoration, and now to open the scriptures. And we believe the Bible is very important for us, and so we hope that you have your own copy. If not, there's a pew Bible in front of you, and we encourage you over the next few moments to consider the scriptures as we have gathered here the first day of the week to celebrate. I have an assignment that I'd like to ask of you, especially for you high school students and college students. Our son-in-law, Professor Matt Lovren, he's Dr. Matt Lovren, he teaches at Grace Christian University. I had the privilege of watching one of his lectures this past week. He put it on YouTube, and he was doing a synopsis, a review of the philosophy class. And it's about a 58-minute lecture, but it is worth your attention and also worth watching. You'll find it on our website. We have the website up on the screen for you if you're not familiar with our website, www.parksidebibleholland.org. You'll find on that page, you will find on the bottom of the page this lecture that he gave. He entitled it Philosophy 311, How to Survive COVID-19. And some of the things that he shares in this lecture, he gives an overview of some of the historical thought process going all the way back into the Old Testament. And I would encourage you as you watch this lecture to take some notes. I'm going to go back and watch it again because he lays out this chart for you and for his students, but it really gives you some idea of where we're at today. If we don't know our history and some of the processes of where we've come from, we won't understand where we're at today. And the modernity culture that we are living in, the modern culture that we're living in, I believe he really hits the nail on the head by giving us, his students, some things to consider on how to survive this coronavirus period of history that we're going through. This is not an easy day that we're living in. This is a very difficult day. And as he was talking to his students, he was identifying some of the things that they're dealing with on the higher education, but that you and I are dealing with every day as we try and live life, and we try and live it normally. Well, what's normal today? There's a new normal. At least that's what they want us to believe. And there's a lot of people that I think today are just giving up. There's times where it gets the better half of my soul, where I just say, you know what, I'm done. I'm done with the masks. I'm done with the social distancing. They change it from 6 feet to 3 feet to 2 feet to 1 feet. It changes like every day. Who do you believe? What do you watch to get your information? All that becomes part of the process of a lot of information that's coming at us that, to be frank, a lot of it you can't trust. And there's lies coming out of left field and right field and center field, and the lies are just all over. And it's like, and you just kind of get to the point where you just say, whatever. And you just kind of walk away from it. I think we've all been there. If you haven't, way to go. Talk to me afterwards. We need to have a biblical, as we said last week, a Christological perspective to weather this tsunami of change that is gripping not just America, but it's gripping the globe. We are seeing changes happen today that a year ago we never would have dreamed. And I'm not sure that the changes are going to stop. And it's affecting all of us in a lot of different ways, from just making it through a day to having mental health to staying spiritually aware of what's going on. I just think that there is, as Dr. Lovren said to his students, I want to give you a survival kit. And his lecture basically ends by saying, here are some survival tools that you need to survive this. And I'd like to suggest that we don't even need to survive it. I think we can thrive. As God's people, I believe God's people can not only just exist, but thrive during this time of pressure and difficulty that I believe is going to continue to press us, God's people, for us to not only stand up and shout the praises, but to stand up and have a voice. Talking to our son, Brian, that many of you know, he's a policeman here in town. I was shocked this past week when I heard the story that my wife, who's on Facebook, she challenged some falseness that was on Facebook. And I basically don't play with Facebook. I try and avoid it. But I work through her. Go get him, Sue. But we told the story to Brian, who we had breakfast with on Friday, and he said, Mom, I just want you to know that as a policeman, I appreciate the fact people buy me breakfast and people buy me lunch, and I appreciate that, and they say nice words, but when you stand up for truth, that means more to me than anything else as a police officer. Stand up for truth. Speak truth. Speak it graciously, but don't be afraid to speak it. It's not a time for us to get silent. We'll sing. Oh, it's one thing to sing, but are we going to speak for truth? We can sing truth, but will we speak for truth in the culture that we're living in today? And I think there's a voice that needs to be heard, a voice of truth. What is truth? Pilate asked. He's right in front of you, Pilate. Christ. And Christ does become, in a general sense, that element of hope. Having said that, I want to give you some survival toolkit concepts this morning from the text that we're going through the book of Mark, and if you have a Bible, turn to Mark chapter 2. We're going verse by verse through this book, and we come to these five verses. It's only five verses, but I have found encouragement in my own soul as I attempted to walk through these verses this past week. And what it does is it, well, let's read it and let's make some observations about it. And hopefully you'll leave here this morning encouraged in your faith. And so Mark chapter 2, begin with verse 18. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. Some people came and asked Jesus, how is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting but yours are not? There's a conversation here that is taking place about fasting. And it was Jewish culture that on the Day of Atonement, they would fast. What we mean by fasting is they wouldn't eat food. When you fast, many times you don't eat food for the purpose of focusing on spiritual things, things that are unseen, not the physical, like food and water. And so the Jews on the Day of Atonement, in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 29, they are commanded to not eat during that Day of Atonement. It's most likely here that John's disciples, which would be John the Baptist's disciples, and the Pharisees' disciples. This is the only place in the New Testament where the Pharisees are identified as having followers or disciples. It was typical in that culture that if there was a leader, a Pharisee that was well known, they would have a group of people they were mentoring, and they would have followers, they would have disciples. And here we find that Mark makes reference to John's disciples and the Pharisees who were fasting. There are some Jews during that day that fasted. Some of the Jews that were really good Pharisees, they fasted Monday and they fasted on Thursday and they fasted twice a week. I mean, there was this whole system of piety that they had. And boy, you only fast once a week. I fast twice a week because I'm just a little bit better than you. And so there was just this whole religious system that was surrounding all of this activity. It's interesting that many of us have probably fasted without us even knowing it. Have you ever had a time in your life where you were under such stress that you didn't eat? Maybe you lost a loved one, you were grieving, there was something that happened in your life, and food just did not seem like the thing to do. You didn't even think about it. You had too many other things on your mind, your other heart. And so fasting, for many of us, fasting is often in the Bible connected to sorrow and difficulty and a sense of grieving. And so we find here that this theme of fasting is brought to the attention here of Jesus, and they ask him the question, why don't your disciples fast? And here's where it gets really exciting, because Jesus is going to take us completely out of fasting, and he's going to move us into left. He's going to take us to a whole different world. Here's what he says. In Mark 2, verse 19, Jesus answered, how can the guest of the bridegroom fast while he is with them? They cannot, so long as they have him with them. But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them, and on that day they will fast. What in the world is Jesus talking about? There's this issue of fasting that he's dealing with, and he talks about the bridegroom and the bride, or not the bride, but the bridegroom and the guest. What is he teaching here? It's interesting that this theme of the coming wedding is what Jesus is wanting his disciples and the followers that are asking him to know. There is coming a day of joy and celebration where there's going to be a wedding, and the bridegroom, who we believe is Jesus Christ, Jesus is the bridegroom, and we'll see that in other passages, and the guest here are the disciples. These people are waiting for the coming together of this feast, this wedding that the Jews were looking for, and Jesus says here that the bridegroom is amongst you. And they didn't need to fast. The disciples didn't need to fast because he was there. He's the bridegroom. But notice the text. It says that there is coming a day when he will be taken from them. And the word here taken means by force. Jesus will be taken. The bridegroom will be taken by force. Then you can mourn and you can fast. When did that happen? Well, biblically, we know of two places when Jesus was by force taken from them. We find that when he was crucified, he was put on the cross and taken from the disciples. I wonder what the disciples did for those 3 days, waiting and wondering what took place. I bet you they fasted, and they probably didn't eat. Now's the time to fast, I think Jesus is saying. Maybe having some prophetic words here spoken about what he was going to do. But there's also a time when the Jews, when Jesus was taken from them, when he ascended up in heaven in Acts chapter 1. He was forcibly taken up into heaven, and the disciples and the nation of Israel was left. Now's the time to mourn because he's no longer with us. Keep your finger here in Mark and turn over to John chapter 3. Look at John chapter 3. John the Baptist, who is the forerunner of Jesus Christ, breaking the 400 years of silence from Malachi to Matthew. For 400 years, there is no prophet that spoke. John the Baptist comes and he breaks the silence. And look at what John the Baptist says about Jesus Christ, claiming him to be the bridegroom in John chapter 3, verse 27. To this, John replied, a person can receive only what is given them from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Messiah, but I am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom awaits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, John the Baptist says. What's the joy? John the Baptist is hearing the voice of the bridegroom speak, and John the Baptist is saying, here's the bridegroom. Jesus is the bridegroom. And when we go back to Mark chapter 2, we're going to find here that the bridegroom is in their midst. They don't need to fast because there's joy with his presence being there. It's interesting that whose, or the question is, if he's the bridegroom, then who's the bride? Who is he going to have a covenant with? Well, we know that God made a covenant with Israel back in Genesis 12 with Abraham and his seed. And we find that the scriptures identify Israel as being the bride of the bridegroom. Let me take you to the last book of the New Testament, the book of Revelation, and turn there with me to Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. We have some language here that is used in this marriage ceremony here right before Jesus comes here to earth in the wedding procession that he will lead in Revelation 19. I believe that the book of Revelation, friends, is a description of the seven-year tribulation period that is all of the birthing pains of that 7 years, with the climax being the birth of Christ by way of the coming of Christ at the end of that seven-year period. And the book of Revelation, I believe, was written for the Jewish nation to give them the details of that seven-year period. And look at Revelation chapter 19, because here's the wedding language in verse 6. Then I heard what sounded like a great multitude, like the roar of rushing waters and the loud peals of thunder, shouting, "Hallelujah, for our Lord God Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory." Look at the next phrase. "For the wedding of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself." Who's the bride here? The bride is Israel. Israel is the bride that prepares herself. And then notice the next phrase in this passage in verse 8. "Fine linen, bright and clean, was given her to wear." As we're going to see in Mark's gospel, the wedding clothes are going to be important, that we're going to see when we get back to Mark chapter 2. Skip over to Revelation chapter 21, and again, some more passages to verify, I believe, who's the bride? The bride is Israel. And look at Revelation chapter 21, verse 2. "I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from heaven, from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling is now among the people, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people.'" Who's the they people here? I believe it's Israel. "He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, mourning, crying, or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." And if you skip down a little bit further in this passage, look at verse 9 through 14, and here John describes, I believe, the bride in detail. And the bride is the new city of Jerusalem that comes down 1,400 miles wide and long and high, is the new city of Jerusalem that is Israel's dwelling, where the kingdom comes down here to earth. The Jewish people have always looked for a literal kingdom here on earth. And this promise here of the bride and the bridegroom is what Jesus, I believe, is teaching in Mark chapter 2. We are not Israel. We are the body of Christ. There's a distinction here. When you look at a couple, the mystery is, yes, they're one flesh, Paul says. Isn't that amazing that there's two people that become one flesh, and they're actually one in, well, wait a minute, there's two people. I wonder if this kind of language also helps us understand the uniqueness of Paul's ministry to us, the church today, because we are not the bride of Christ, we are the body of Christ. Paul uses that language over and over again about us, the church, the body of Christ. That's a language that is very Pauline. And that Pauline language, there's a oneness that marriage ceremony will bring when the heavens and the earth, our citizenship, friends, is where? In the heavens. Our citizenship is in the heavens as the church, the body of Christ. Where is the citizenship for the Jews? Here on earth. They're looking for that coming kingdom. They're looking for that promise when God will establish and there'll be shalom. And someday there will be a wedding of all weddings, a wedding feast where the heavens and the earth will be consummated together, and the bridegroom will come to Israel, and they will come together, and then the heavens and the earth, and there's a newness that is happening in the world today that began with the Holy Spirit's outpouring in Acts chapter 2. The old things have been done away with. The new things are becoming new. And that's kind of the overview here of what we see in this passage. Turn over to Matthew chapter 22. Matthew chapter 22. I want to show you a parable here that Jesus teaches, and this language of the wedding feast is very much a language that is Jewish in flavor and has Jewish roots going all the way back to the Old Testament. Look at Matthew chapter 22, beginning with verse 1. This is a great parable of the wedding banquet. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying the kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some servants and said, tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet. But they, I'm going to read into this text, not read into it, but I'm going to interpret the text with other text here. They, the Pharisees, the religious leaders, paid no attention to Jesus. And they went off, one to the field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. The city of Jerusalem was burned in 70 AD. Historically, you'll see the philosophical thinking of the Greek world and the Roman world. Historically, we can trace that. But in that philosophical, historical tracing, there's the work of God that is happening in this world. Let's keep reading. Verse 8. Then he said to his servants, the wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find. So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find. The bad, that is, the sinners and tax collectors. I think this parable here, many see this as being a turning to the Gentiles. I don't believe that's it. I think the nation of Israel, the religious leaders were held responsible and accountable for what they did with Jesus. They rejected. So who did he go to? He went to those who were down and out, the tax collectors and sinners that he was eating with last week. We saw that in the early book of chapter 2 of Mark. So we find here that this wedding banquet is prepared and ready, but they go out and they fill the room, and the room is filled. Let me just read verse 11, because we're going to tie this in with Mark 2 here in just a moment. But when the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man who was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, how did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend? And the man was speechless. And the wedding clothes are going to be some of the theme that we're going to find in Mark chapter 2. And so the wedding feast and the wedding is yet a future event that brings us today where we're living. How do we live in this coronavirus survival kit begins by seeing the big picture. God is preparing this world for the second coming of Christ. And some of the events that we might be seeing, the rise of China as being the superpower, the next superpower, is biblically, and it falls in line with some of the last days. Because one of the things that we find in the last days is there is an army of over 2 million that come from the east on the last battle that happens in the land of Israel to try and annihilate the Jews. The nations come from all, Russia from the north, China from the east, and all of the nations rally together to try and wipe out the nation of Israel and take them off of the face of the earth. Without the nation of America, America has been the strength of Israel. We have been pro-Israel for many, many years. If that stops, they will stand by themselves, which they are going to do. And I believe you are seeing and you are witnessing some of the changes that are happening very quickly, moving to the day when Jesus will come back a second time. And some of these events that are recorded for us in the scriptures, I believe we're seeing the stage not being fulfilled. I don't believe that prophecy is being fulfilled today. I believe the stage is being set. When the curtain is pulled up and the church is taken out, then Israel is going to be the focal point again as God is going to deal with the nation of Israel, and he will prepare them in that seven-year period, and he will purify the 144,000 for their coming Messiah. And on that day, they will look at the one that they have pierced, Zechariah 14, and say, he's our Messiah. We missed him the first time, but we're not going to miss him the second time. And when they bend the knee, When they bow the knee, as Israel bends the knee, and Jerusalem will be the place in Revelation 19 that he goes into the city and he establishes his kingdom. That will be a day like no other. So that's the big picture. Let's go back, if we can, to Mark chapter 2, and let's see some other language here with the clock running fast, but we got a couple of other verses here that we want to deal with. Mark chapter 2. This is just an amazing theme here, friends. For me personally, it breathes life and hope into the day that I live, because it does get heavy at times, and it's like, man, where is this going? Oh, yeah, we're heading towards this glorious day. Keep your eyes up. See the big picture. That's part of the survival kit that I think we need to have. But look at the Mark chapter 2. There are two elements here that he calls attention to in this teaching. Mark chapter 2, verse 21. No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the new piece will pull away from the old, making the tear worse. Why is he talking about clothing here in the context of a bridegroom and a wedding? Because this, my friends, has everything to do with wearing the right clothes for the wedding feast. And this is rooted in the Old Testament. I want to give you just a list of a number of passages in the Old Testament that talk about the righteousness of the bridegroom, what he will wear when he comes in to the wedding, and also what the bride will be wearing by, and what that is it is the clothing of righteousness. Listen to Job chapter 29, verse 14. I put on righteousness as my clothing. Justice will be my robe and my turban. I think he's talking there about the Messiah who's going to come. Job is the oldest book that we know of in the scriptures. And Job here, I think, is doing a prophetic look at what the bridegroom is going to be wearing. He's going to be wearing righteousness as his clothing, and justice will be his robe and his turban. When you read Revelation chapter 19, some of the scenes that John sees and what Job sees fit together. A couple other passages, Isaiah chapter 59, verse 17. He put righteousness like a breastplate and a helmet of salvation on his head. And he put on garments of vengeance for clothing and wrapped himself with zeal as a mantle. Isaiah 11, verse 5. Also righteousness will be the belt about his loins and faithfulness the belt around his waist. The bridegroom is dressed in righteousness. Isaiah 61, verse 10. I will rejoice greatly in the Lord, so my soul will exalt my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation. He has wrapped me with a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and a bride adorns herself with her jewels. All of this language is connected to this idea of the bridegroom and the bride preparing themselves for the wedding feast. Psalm 132, verse 9. Let your priests be clothed with righteousness, and let your godly ones sing for joy. And there I believe that the psalmist is talking about Israel being the nation that will clothe themselves with righteousness, and they need to have the right clothes on. And then Isaiah will say it this way when it comes to wearing the wrong clothes. Isaiah 64, verse 6, for all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. And all of us wither like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away. The gospel that came to the nation of Israel, the presentation of Christ to this nation, they didn't as a nation receive it, so the nation of Israel was taken and set aside. And now the gospel comes to us with that same foundation. What clothes do you need to wear to be received in the sight of God? And here's where the scripture now teaches us that it's not our righteousness, it's not what we do, it's the righteousness of him. Because he's the Savior, he's our Messiah, he's the one, he's the head of the church. He becomes the focal point. And Paul will say it this way in Romans chapter 4, verses 3 and 5. What does the scripture say? Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but an obligation. However, to the one who does not work, but trusts God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. So the gospel that we believe and teach is a gospel of being saved by grace through faith. Your righteousness, my righteousness, is nothing but filthy rags. We can't stand before a holy and a righteous God with what we wear. Don't try it. You'll be judged and condemned because your sin and my sin condemns us. So what do we need? We need faith in the Lord Jesus. Look what the scripture says. You give God the faith to believe in Christ, and he will give you his righteousness. There's an exchange that takes place. I believe, and he gives me and clothes me with his righteousness. There's the gospel that the nation of Israel missed. There's the gospel that the Pharisees missed. Some of the sinners, if you're sick, you need a savior. Mark chapter 2 last week. But if you're not sick, you don't need a doctor. But if you're sick, here's where we go. We come to Christ for salvation. And so we find that the clothing theme becomes part of the teaching here of Jesus. And there's one last really exciting theme here that I wish we had time to expound, because this is just filled with all kinds of language of the future coming kingdom. It's the kingdom language of the wine bottle, or the wine that is coming. And here's what Jesus teaches in verse 22. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and both the wine and the wineskins will be ruined. No, they pour new wine into new wine. Why is he talking about wine and wineskins? Because the theme of wine, what was the first miracle that Jesus performed in the scriptures? He turned water into wine. Why? He did that to tell the nation of Israel, your Messiah is here and the coming kingdom is coming. And wine was connected to the coming Messiah's kingdom that would drip new wine from the hills. Let me just give you some Old Testament passages. And again, because of time, we don't have time to look at all of these, but I'll list them for you on the screen, and you can maybe jot these down. The book of Joel is a book about the day of the Lord. It's the coming of Christ the second time. And there's language in this book, like in chapter 2, verse 19. I'm sending you grain, new wine, and olive oil. Verse 24 of chapter 2, the vats will overflow with new wine. Chapter 3, verse 18, in that day the mountains will drip new wine, and the hills will flow with milk. Make sure that you look at Amos chapter 9, verse 13 and 14. Let me just read these two verses. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when the reaper will be overtaken by the plowman and the planter by the one treading grapes. New wine will drip from the mountains and flow from the hills. And I will bring my people Israel back from exile. They will rebuild the ruined cities and live in them. They will plant vineyards and drink their wine. They will make their gardens and eat their fruit. What is new wine connected to? It's connected to the joy that is coming by the new covenant. That new covenant, we believe, was rejected by Israel, but now we have been given the spiritual blessings as the church, the body of Christ today, to survive the pressures of what the church goes through in this historical moment. This is a historical moment like no other. This is the day to be alive. This is a day that our ancestors would have never thought that they would have seen. Don't think for a moment that this is not the time to be alive. You are witnessing, and we are going to, I believe, witness some things that will continue to move this setting forward. And don't think for a moment that this is beyond what God can allow the church to handle. But you and I are living like in a day like no other. In fact, there's even a greater day coming when that wedding ceremony, when all things will become new, when the heavens and the earth become united. What a day that will be. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6, again because of time, I wish we could unpack this, but this passage, Paul talks about the new covenant. What is the new covenant? It's the Spirit's work and the indwelling of the Spirit of God that we are witnessing today in this age of grace. And this age of grace is where the Spirit of God indwells us. And now we live by a new letter. It's not the old, but it's the new covenant, and it's bringing all things new. God is renewing all things from the inside out, and he's starting in the soul by way of the Spirit's work of what he's doing today in the church. He has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant, Paul says. Not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. The old was written on stone tablets. The Ten Commandments were written on stone tablets. The new is written on human hearts, your heart. You and I as believers become the source of truth that the world needs to not only see, but also to hear. The old brings condemnation, brings death. The new brings freedom. The old results in death. The new results in life. It's abundant life. It's glorious life. It wells up. The Spirit of God wants to well itself up through us as believers. The old says, do this and you shall live. The new says, because you now live, do. Bringing all of this together, the fasting theme of Mark chapter 2 gives us the bigger picture. It's not about fasting. It's not about a religious system. It's about a Spirit-filled life. There is a wedding ceremony that's coming when Israel, the bride, and the bridegroom, Christ, will come together and be united in joyful celebration of dancing and gladness that the world has not seen yet. And we, the church, are this body of Christ that God has called us to be a part of that brings this age to an end, and we believe that the end of this age for us as believers is the rapture of the church. We will by force be taken up, and when the church is raptured up to meet the Lord in the air, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, then God will deal with the nation of Israel again. And the big picture here of what God is doing, God is at work. Don't think for a moment that the heavens are silent. He is sitting on his throne and he is sovereign. And when the foundations of the world begin to crumble, Psalm 11, when the foundations begin to crumble, the psalmist says, the Lord sits on his holy throne. And that's where our focus needs to be. Don't give up. I know it's tough. It's difficult. There's challenges every day. Every day, I believe that. And as you go through those challenges, stay strong in your faith. Believe the big picture here of what God is doing. Stay close to one another. I know that this is a time where they say, put space between you. Do what you can to stay safe, but stay close to each other. This is not a time to retreat back into your homes and stay away from God's people. If you are, and I say if, because some of you might not be saved, some of you might think you're saved, but you've never put your faith and your trust in Christ, and you are like the Pharisees. You're putting your faith in the wrong thing. If you don't know him, come to him in faith and become part of a community. We need community. And we need community more than in a big setting like this. We need community in smaller pockets where we go out and we play softball and we reclaim the truth of who we are, even though we're not doing Bible studies, and even though we might not be praying, we are connecting with each other. We need that connection like never before. So this is not a time to retreat. It is a time to stand firm and to believe that the big picture is being worked out. Hang in there. God is faithful, and God is going to be faithful this next week. If he doesn't come back this next week, we'll be back here again, reclaiming and restating the big picture so that we can live in a way that pleases him and brings honor and glory to him. Let's bow our heads and our hearts in a word of prayer, shall we? Our Father in heaven, it is with great joy that we are thankful for your Son that gives us the righteousness that we so desperately need. Thank you that it's by faith, believing what he has done for us and continues to do and what he's going to continue to do in the days to come. Thank you, Father, for your sovereignty. Thank you for the wedding feast that is yet before us historically, and we can trace history, but we know where it ultimately ends, and it ends at your throne. And so, Father, give us that big picture a survival kit that will help us live yet another day, another week, in your plans and purposes. Thank you for these moments to be able to open the scriptures. I pray that it was honoring to you. Thanks, Father, for letting us babble through it. Sometimes it's much bigger than any of us. And so, thanks for your grace. Thanks for your joy and your love and all that comes with your Son, the Lord Jesus. For it's in his name we pray. Amen. We began the service this morning with a hymn of praise. It's Because He Lives. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. And we began with that song, and I think it would be good for us to finish the service sending us forth with this song of praise. And so crank up the volume, and let's sing this hymn with great joy and celebration. Let's stand. If you'd like to sing it from the hymn book, it's hymn number 238. So you could take the hymn book out and you can sing. Let's stand together and let's sing.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to
Blessings.